Hello YouTube and welcome to Heathen Hacks. Today we're going to have a look at the ThermoPro TP-65A, a wireless hygrometer and temperature monitor that I would be using to monitor the temperature and humidity inside and outside of my room. The indoor unit would be on my desk and the remote sensor would be placed outside the window to make sure that the humidity level doesn't get too high because I suffer sinusitis every time that it does. I'm also going to use it to log both the temperature and humidity every time I turn my AC on and off. We'd also go through the super easy setup process, do some tests, a review, and then by the end of it, I'd show you what I used as an enclosure to keep it safe from direct rainfall. Let's go! So, here's the box. Rechargeable wireless indoor-outdoor humidity and temperature monitor. Not sure why it says that, the only rechargeable thing here is the outdoor remote sensor. Anyway, this is the model TP-65A. There are various other versions available for certain usage as well. Alright, let's open it up. Inside the box is the USB to DC barrel jack cable to charge the built-in 3.7 volts 18650 lithium-ion battery of the remote sensor. It doesn't say the battery capacity though, which is a bit weird, I don't know. Here's the remote sensor that can be placed inside or outside of the house. As you may have noticed, it does not look new at all. Well, that's because I bought it last July and have been using it since then. That's correct, I already used it before I did the unboxing. This is the LED indicator that flashes every time it sends an update tick to the base station, receiver, or indoor unit. The LED would steadily light up with the color red when it's charging and would change to a steady green when it's done. It transmits at 433 MHz frequency with a maximum power of 8 milliwatts to not mess with typical Wi-Fi and or Bluetooth signals. Some FCC guidelines or rules. Here's the outdoor unit's charging port that only accepts 5 volts DC. This is the power button. Inside this one is the reset button and outdoor unit channel selector. In order to access the channel selector and reset button, we have to open it up using a Phillips head screwdriver. And of course, I'm going to take this chance to use my Aria 142-in-1 tech toolkit again. Click right here to check it out. Let's see. So the reset switch is located just above the selector. As you can see here, the selector has 3 numbers. These numbers represent what channel the remote sensor is set to, and would display the data onto the base station accordingly. The base station can accommodate a maximum of 3 remote sensors which can be placed around the house. One in the kitchen, one at the garage, and one outside for example. This model comes with one remote sensor included, and according to the website, additional remote sensors can be bought separately. The rubber O-ring here is for water to not get into the unit and mess with the electronics inside. Written on the sticker is a precaution that basically says that the temperature and humidity sensors are located at the bottom of it, so direct water or rainfall would mess with the results. The user manual also said that even though the remote sensor is designed to be waterproof, The user manual also said that even though the remote sensor is designed to be rainproof, it's preferable to place it in a dry location to avoid direct rainfall and sunlight for more precise and quick environmental temperature and humidity readings. Right, if I'm not mistaken, this is the thermometer and this is the hygrometer or humidity sensor. Now, this is the base station or indoor unit that displays the readings from the remote sensor or sensors. It also has its own thermometer and hygrometer. Not sure what this hole is for though, it doesn't seem to have any buttons inside to be a reset button. Included with the unit are 2 AAA batteries. It has 2 wall mounting options, you can either use the hanging hole or magnets. Or just use the stand and put it on your desk. I suggest to just use the stand since hanging it on a wall might impede the sensors because the airflow would be a little limited. Here we have 4 touch-sensitive buttons. First on the left is channel sync. Pressing it would display the temperature and humidity readings from up to 3 remote sensors. Long pressing it would make the base station enter synchronization mode with the remote sensor. Second is the backlight switch. Pressing the light bulb icon would turn the backlight on or off. It would also turn the backlight off itself after 15 seconds to save battery. Third is the temperature display and history. Pressing it would change the temperature display to either Fahrenheit or Celsius. Max, min, and clear. Pressing this once would display the all-time recorded minimum and maximum temperature and humidity, while long pressing it would clear the recorded history. Pressing the temperature display and history button after max min and clear, however, would display the recorded maximum and minimum temperature and humidity during the duration of 24 hours. Both all-time and 24 hours represent the time since you last manually cleared the history data or record or installed a new battery. This RF indicator would blink continuously for around 3 minutes, indicating that the base station is in synchronization mode and is waiting for the remote sensor to be registered. Now let's do some tests. As you can see here, even if both of the units are inside, temperature and humidity readings differ quite a bit. Temperature is usually 1 degree off and 8% off on the humidity. Which is not that bad really, I just don't know the reason why. Okay, I've just set my AC to 24 degrees Celsius. Let's see how long before the temperature values change. I faced the sensors of the remote sensor to the back because the indoor unit's sensors are at the back as well. About 2 minutes in and the temperature changed from 27.4 degrees Celsius to 27.1 and from 65% humidity to 62. I also forgot to mention that both of the units are under LED lights, so that might affect the temperature reading slightly. Not so sure about that though. While we're at it, here's the included user manual and the remote sensor's hanging screw. At around 5 minutes, temperature went down by 0.4 degrees and humidity is down by 6%. And for the last remaining minutes of the test, I've set my AC to 16 degrees Celsius. As you can see here, the humidity is going on a downward trend because the humidity keeps on decreasing. After the test, which lasted for just a few minutes because I don't want the electricity bill to increase that much, the temperature went down by just almost 1 degree and the humidity went down by 10%. Just goes to show that air conditioners are really effective at removing humidity from the atmosphere. Now, as I have mentioned earlier, according to the manual, even though the product is rain or waterproof, these sensors at the bottom of it still needs to be protected. And what better thing to use as an outdoor enclosure than a weatherproof junction box? It eliminates the need for us to make a custom one, and it just requires some modifications. As you can see here, this is IP65 rated, which is basically weatherproof. Let's open it up then. So we'd make some holes on these plugs right here for the remote sensor to have access to outside air. And since I'm planning on placing it outside the window for easy access when it needs to be charged, I'm just going to add some neodymium magnets here, 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 and here, using super glue for it not to fall. I'm going to add some magnets to the other side of the window as well to hold it in place. I'm also going to add some sort of safety string here so that if it suddenly falls for some reason, the string would catch it and hold on to it and not let it fall down. Well, camera's battery died, so here are some photos I took using my mobile phone to show what I did. Currently waiting for the first pair of neodymium magnets to dry up. As you can see, I've made some sort of scratches on where I would attach the magnet so that the super glue would have more places to hold on to. Now that it's done, let's proceed on making some holes onto these plugs. There we go, holes are big enough to not restrict airflow and mess with the results. And then, for easy removal of the remote sensor from the enclosure, I just used some double-sided tape to hold it in place. Of course, I used my pair of scissors again, aptly named Scissor. First name Julius. Place the double-sided tape like this and then the remote sensor like this. This is what it would look like under it. Now, just to make sure that the neodymium magnets would not interfere with the signal, I placed the junction box with the remote sensor inside our freezer. And as you can see here, there are no signaling issues, because the remote sensor, despite it being inside the junction box and inside the freezer, it still transmits data. Right here, I have just placed the remote sensor outside the window, and this is what it looks like inside. I know it's dirty, okay, but it's hidden under the blackout curtain, so it doesn't matter much. This is what it would look like outside. Again, I know it's dirty. I just can't reach it to clean it properly because we're on the second floor. All I need to do now is add the safety string, and since I have this solid core hookup wire just lying around, this is what I used. Tied it up to one of the railings, and it's done. Now for the review. I really like its features, it's super easy to set up and having a wireless sensor is really handy. No more cables that could be hard to manage or get tangled up and get chipped. I would know because I owned a wired one before. It only has a wired temperature sensor that I used to wrap in plastic so that it won't get wet and corrode. It also doesn't have a hygrometer, so I wouldn't know the humidity percentage outside. So when I saw this online, I immediately looked for its specs and what it can do, and bought one immediately during the sale. Ever since using it, I've learned, or at least relearned, that how I feel inside the room does not entirely depend on temperature alone. It also relies on humidity. Logging in the data from the base station every time I turn on and turn off my AC also have allowed me to use and turn on my AC at the right time of day. I've noticed that when I turn on my AC at around 3 PM, the electricity consumption seems to be higher when compared to when I turn it on at around 1 PM. Even if the duration of the latter is longer, because apparently, the outside temperature reaches to up to 34 degrees Celsius at around 3 PM and would therefore make the AC work harder to cool the room initially. I used that data to save on electricity, and in the end, have lower electric bills. But that's for another video. My apologies if I got sidetracked a little. Now, me praising it does not mean that I'm blinded to its shortcomings. First, it's quite on the expensive side. Well, for me at least. Second, the fact that the base station and a remote sensor give different readings even if they are both inside the same room can be quite bothersome. Yeah, I guess that's about it. I mean, battery life-wise, the remote sensor I think can last for about a month or two before it needs to be recharged. So that's really good. And you'd also get a notification when it needs to charge or when the base unit needs a battery replacement. And because the battery inside the remote sensor is an 18650, it would be easily replaceable when the need for it arises. It also has a free pair of batteries to use, which most products these days don't even include anymore, which is a nice touch. So yeah, that's all for today, guys. Thanks for watching and see you again next week. Maybe.